Good morning, everybody. Glad that you're all here, made it here today, even on Friday. So my name is Sini Pöytäniemi. I come from the National Land Survey of Finland. And today I'll be telling you about the state of Oskari for the end user point of view. Later today, my colleague Sami, who is also here, will be telling about Oskari for developers. So don't worry, just join that one if you didn't get all the answers right now. So my presentation will have first the introduction to Oskari. So what is the software, what is the community, and then I'll share some news, both from the community as well and on the software. And I'll go more in detail in introducing the Oskari admin user interface that has had some changes, not only in the last year, but let's say last 5 years. So, Oskari is an open source map framework. It supports spatial data infrastructure, standardized OGC APIs, and supports data interoperability and also Inspire. It's been implemented as a collection of reusable bundles and is customizable. Oskari enables you to creating a geoportal for viewing maps that you bring in as OGC or distributed web map APIs, such as WMS, WFS, OGC features, and others, which you then use on a web browser. Now it is also fluently on a mobile, on browser. There's quite an advanced, nice, easy-to-use admin user interface for importing these map APIs. And there's easy role-based user management. One of the core functionalities is publishing web maps, embedded web maps. So you can embed them on a website without any actual coding skills. So we aim it to be as easy as possible. And then if you want, you can use RPC to actually enrich those embedded maps in more advanced ways. A few examples of what Oskari can do. So you can create, edit your own feature by drawing. So here I've created a dummy polygon here. So this is just to show how the tool looks like. It's very easy to use. You have to save it as a my place, as a feature, choose which map layer you want to choose to save it to. And then you can use it later or publish it in an embedded map if you wish. There are different time series tools for showing, for example, WMST old aerial photos from National Land Survey here. They're quite a nice tool for browsing through historical data. There's the possibility to search and view metadata. So, for example, our national geoportal is connected to the national metadata service. So, with this interaction, you can basically search for the data and then look and see that data on the map as well and see where it comes from, who is the responsible data producer. And then there's the publishing of embedded maps. This was also enhanced quite recently, the user interface here. I think it's an easy to use user interface for anybody to actually create a publishable map and just put it on their own website. Not going to go into detail today in all of these, but try it yourself if you want. There are quite a few other functionalities. Such as you can upload your own data, so shapefiles or geopackage. You can share links with markers. There's the thematic statistical maps that you can use, measuring distances, areas, searching place names and addresses, and things like these, quite basic map tools. On the right in the image, you can see there is a, we call it a swipe tool, so you can compare two overlaying map layers to each other. A couple of our use cases. So somebody might have been in a presentation earlier this week by Natalia Räikkönen from Southwest Finland. They are using Oskari to publish their maps. So they have collected all the possible spatial maps, map WMS, WFS from their area, or publishing their own data and bringing it in here. There's the Statistics Finland, who's using it. Here is a population grid, 5 kilometers, I think. And they've got lots of different statistical data there as well. One of the quite cool examples is SDR Geoportal. So it has map data from eight different Arctic countries, trying to create a geoportal or like a view place for Arctic data, different kind of themes, also producing data, but then they have the geoportal where you can actually see what is available. And then I come from National Land Survey, so we also have a couple of different OSCAR instances, I think 7 different map services that we have. One of them is the map site, as we call it, which is actually an RPC implementation. So you have the OSCAR embedded map on the background, but then you have used RPC on top of it to create more functionality and different looks on it. There's a OSCAR community. We have created this OSCAR RPC examples webpage. So this was also renewed lately, updated. So to find out what can you do exactly with RPC, so you should go on this website and try it yourself quite easily. And then there are a couple of other use cases, mostly from the public sector, public administration in Finland, but a couple of others as well. They are mostly based, all of them in Finland, but then there's one at least in Indonesia that I know of, but all the documentation we do is actually in English, so I mean anybody could use it, it's not geographically limited in that sense. Just happens that it's the public administration that has now kind of taken the, I don't know, ownership of this project somehow, so they've been using it a lot. So we have an OSCAR community. There's in the core, there's a joint development forum with currently 7 different organizations. So these members co-fund development, bug fixes, and communication, and they meet all about monthly basis. There's a project steering committee, which steers the code, let's say. Community coordinator at the moment is National Land Survey Finland, has always been, could in theory be somebody else, but we've been contributing a lot and have a big interest in it. And then there's a communications coordinator that is funded by the Joint Development Forum, who is producing blog posts and other documentation stuff. And then there is the larger community, like the, let's say the unofficial community, where you have active people from different organizations and other OSCAR users that are not officially part of the Joint Development Forum. And then we have this oscari.org website for all support material and documentation. Some community activities in the past year, we have been renewing the oscari.org website and brand. You've seen somebody, if you are familiar with Oscari, you might have been wondering that the logo has changed, so there's the new otter, Oscari Otter, created last year sometime, but that's part of actually of renewing the website itself, which should be published sometime in the autumn. As I said, the RPC example site had been improved. We've been discussing a lot about the accessibility of web maps, not only regarding the directive, but also what is actually needed in terms of accessibility from maps and what is actually realistic to do. We have community days annually, and then we have a new communications coordinator since January. So there's been lots of new blog posts and such coming up. But what is new in the OSCAR user interface now? We released 2.12, 2.13 releases in the past year. The biggest change is from the point of view of an end user, mobile use. Thematic maps went to React with some enhancements, and then the admin user phase had some improvements in the roles attribute field filtering, and in there's something called JSON field in the admin user phase. I'll show you show you soon. And then there was the map publishing as well, missing from the list here. So mobile use has been on the wish list for some time, and it wasn't exactly very usable on mobile earlier. So last autumn, big changes were made to this so that it's actually usable on mobile and works quite nicely. Some of the functionalities have been reduced, so you can configure which functionalities you take with, and those that don't work well, maybe you don't want to have them there. And not all special tools, GIS tools there that you could do are realistic to use on mobile anyway. But now you can browse the maps and do basic things on mobile as well. And it works quite nicely. Thematic maps are now in React, so there is the statistical APIs that you can take in, use them, and show the data on the map. So like here, population data from Statistics Finland. We have in Finland, in this National Geoportal, we have a couple of different data sources for it, like in addition to Statistics Finland. And you can create quite impressive thematic maps with it, choosing the year and area that you want to use, and also the way you want to actually show the map, maybe in Coroplit or something else. But then I want to go dive in a little bit more in the Oscari admin user interface. So there's been a change from jQuery to React in the past 4 or 5 years or so, and also in the last year, a few enhancements were made. It's a continuous improvement. I mean, there's always new wishes that what people want to do with the admin user interface. But it's already in a very, very good state, if you ask me. I will run you through of how you add a new map layer in here. So first, if you come into the GeoPortal as a guest user, so on the left side is what you would see. So the list of different map layers. You can toggle the maps on or off on to view them. And then you can see if it's a raster map, it's a vector map, and then there's a little info tool where you can actually open all the metadata related to this map data, map layer. But then if you enter as an admin user, you would have a couple of new tools there. So you'd see these little pens for editing and the plus sign on the right. And there's actually this cool tool here, which almost able to use. So the plus sign here is where you would start adding new map layers. So this is the upper one is then what happens. Oops. So we're going to be adding a WFS layer. It could be open API features layers as well. But there are other options, WMS, WMDS, different kind of ArcGIS layers, Cesium 3D tiles, Mapbox vector tiles, and Bing, for example, now that you could choose from. So then you would add the URL, choose which version you're using. And then here you get a list of all the map layers that are available behind that service, choose one of them. And then basically what you could do already now is click save. And you would have a map layer. But you could also add a username and password if needed. Change a few things here and there, maybe the most important, the name which you want to show in the GeoPortal, and that in different languages if you wish. So our GeoPortal main language is Finnish, but we also have everything translated to English and Swedish as well. And then you could choose which is the data provider you want to use and which is the theme or the group that you want to use there. So then in here, we have different sites, different parts where you can choose what you do with it. So general visualization, additional JSON permissions. So we'll go through some of these now. So you can choose what is the opacity of the data, what is the scale that the map layer would be shown. You could check this map layer coverage, which is here. So if you click it on, you can actually view on the map view what is the extent of this data. Sometimes there are some issues with these services not having this, and then you could maybe start some problem solving there. Collection types, bit more advanced tools here, feature highlighting and tooltips, and things like this. In the additional part, you can, for example, check what is the actual unique identifier in the database for this data, for also for searching and problem solving with the database easier than with a long map layer names or service names. You can check the capabilities that have been parsed. You could have the metadata identifier put manually here, or you can just get it from directly from the service itself, from the capabilities. You can choose the geometry type if you want, and do here also, this is something that is quite new, so you could do feature filtering, select properties, labeling, formatting. This is quite cool, new things that you could do. And then for more advanced users, you could also use this JSON. So all of the JSON is collected here under one site. And if you want, you can start doing modifications here. But for regular users, I would say that don't touch this. And then permissions. So we're here. You can choose if the different roles can view. They can view maps on embedded maps. They can download. They can. Which one is missing? Publish the data. So quite easy to use. There are quite a few other admin tools as well, like for, how do I go back? Yes, like for the permissions, you could also admin these on one window instead of doing one layer at a time. Since there's only 3 minutes time, I'm going to hurry up a little bit. So Oskari roadmap, we don't have a very official strict roadmap. What we are doing is we are trying to plan ahead what is needed. And we are balancing between the technical continuity of the software, the admin users, the end users have different needs that come up, and then there are the community activities. So it's always balancing and prioritizing between these when we have the resources to actually do the development. And the JDF, the Joint Development Forum, is coordinating this, but in practice, National Land Survey of Finland is contributing most of the code, so lots of the needs would reflect what we need. But we try always make it so that it's usable by everybody who's using Oskari. And then smaller contributions would come up also from the community elsewhere. Some goals for the coming years. So. There will be some finishing touches for moving from jQuery to React, such as Map Publisher. We have in National Land Survey, we have this geoportal, National Geoportal, with over 3,000 map layers. So there's some admin needs regarding that reporting and monitoring and things like this. So we want to improve that. We've been discussing the accessibility, so there will be some minor changes in there to improve it. And then there is a long-term issue of combining own places and data sets. So this data that users would create themselves on the geoportal, or they would import, and we want to make that more manageable on the database level. And many other developments. Coming up, so there will be a new Oskari website coming up in autumn. Not public just yet, but the old website is oskari.org, will be the same domain then. Welcome to come and have a look then. And then there will be instructions for procuring Oskari, which might interest many who are thinking if they should or they want to procure a new Oskari instance or even do configurations to an old one. So we've been trying to make a instructions of what to think when you're doing this, what are the questions you should have in mind. And then there are a few upcoming events. As I said, Sami will be presenting later today the state of Oskari for developers. Please join there. There will be a new website, and there will also in Finnish be a webinar about the basics of Oskari. If there would be a request to do that in English, we would gladly do that, but so far it will be only in Finnish. And then there will be a developer's day, like a workshop sometime early 25. Thank you. That's all I wanted to say, and I think it went quite strict on time. Thanks.
Okay, we have time for questions. So, any questions?
Hi, Ville Koivisto from Ubiku. Thank you for the presentation. It was really interesting to see. Are there any updates on the incubation process with OSGO?
The question I didn't want to answer. It's been on hold for years, and there hasn't been much happening. We've been trying to concentrate on activating the community itself and on the actual work, and the incubation process has been on hold.
Okay. But the goal remains the same for you guys?
So far, I think we should think if we want to be a community, how does it say, a community member? If the incubation is something that we can't do in a couple of coming years. We should look into it, but been concentrating on other things, unfortunately. Thanks.
Thank you.
Moi.
Moi, Timo.
Some time ago, you developed the kind of monitoring thingy for Oskari, monitoring the different services if they had troubles. Has there been any advancements in that, or will there be anything in Sami's presentation about that?
I think there won't be anything in Sami's presentation. There hasn't been happening anything that much in the past year that we would prioritize presenting it now, but I can't remember exactly what was the stage it was when you saw it last time, so you should maybe come and test it. But yeah, there's a monitoring monitoring thing where you can check if the map layers, so from the coming from WMS, OGC, API features, whatever the services, if they actually work on the map. So when you have 3,000 map layers, you can't manually be clicking each of them. So you need some stats or reporting coming up. So we've been developing a tool where you can check how many errors are coming up. If there's just one error, maybe it was temporary, but if it's actually 100% test error, yeah, there should be a red flag. You're going to have to fix it somehow and maybe check with the data producer, like, what is going on? Yeah. Maybe if nothing else, I mean, check our website and you can ask me and Sami and, I mean, other guys here. You know. One more?
Thanks. Maybe it's a bit of a technical question, so I'm not sure if it's the right time. But I'm wondering the embedding part. I guess it's not an iframe option, it's kind of embedding using the DOM elements. Or is that a too tricky question? Really?
It is an iframe. It's this much of code that you need to add to HTML somewhere. And
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Super easy.
Okay, thanks.